this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike. Welcome to Lecture 6 of Tradecraft, Post-Exploitation with Meterpreter. In this lecture, we're going to talk about Meterpreter and how to use it. We're going to cover Cobalt Strike's browser pivoting technology. We're going to talk about privilege escalation and how to pivot through Meterpreter. Meterpreter is a remote administration tool built into the Metasploit framework, originally developed by Matt Miller. There are multiple implementations of Meterpreter. There's Windows Meterpreter, which is very feature-rich and robust, Java Meterpreter, which is pretty good, not as full-featured as Windows Meterpreter, but pretty good, and there are other implementations as well, PHP Meterpreter, Linux Meterpreter, and Python Meterpreter. Each of those are at differing levels of maturity. What's cool about Meterpreter is Meterpreter can communicate through multiple channels. It can connect back to you, the attacker, making a TCP connection. It can communicate over HTTP or HTTPS. Meterpreter can also speak IPv6. Depending on how you got it onto the system, possibly with a memory corruption exploit, Windows Meterpreter can live entirely in memory. It can also migrate to different processes. When you have a Meterpreter session on a host, Cobalt Strike gives you a Meterpreter menu attached to that host. The Meterpreter menu is broken up as follows. The Access menu are options to escalate, protect, and pass your session. The Explore menu are options to spy on the user. The Interact menu are options to control the system. The Kill menu will kill your Meterpreter session. Okay, here we are in Cobalt Strike. Let's go to Cobalt Strike, Listeners, press Add, and let's define a Windows Meterpreter listener. We'll call it WinMeterp. Let's choose our payload, Windows Meterpreter reverse TCP, and put in a port, 8989, for example. Press Save. We now have a Meterpreter listener running on port 8989. Great. Now, let's go to View, Beacons, and task our beacon to give us a Meterpreter session. Right-click, Spawn, WinMeterp, Choose. When Beacon checks in next, we will have a Meterpreter session. There we are. Now, when I right-click on the system, I have a Meterpreter menu. We have the Access options, Interact, and Explore. That's where we're going to focus for now. Let's go through the Interact options. Interact Command Shell gives me a Command Shell. Meterpreter Interact Meterpreter Shell gives me a Metasploit Framework Meterpreter shell. Here, I can type Meterpreter commands with tab completion and do whatever I want. This goes with the Cobalt Strike philosophy that it should not take away any of the power of the Metasploit framework from you. You can also go and interact with the user's desktop and watch what they're doing. This option will stage a VNC server in memory and connect to it tunneled over Meterpreter. Give it a moment to come up. Here we are. We have a VNC session. By default, the VNC viewer is view only. Click on this little spy icon to make it so you can actually interact with the desktop. So let me click on that. And now I can actually control the user's system through this tab. Click on this little icon to change the desktop to fit in the tab as well, which is really nice. Another thing you can do in Cobalt Strike, press Control T, and Cobalt Strike will take a screenshot of the current tab. It could be a VNC tab, it could be any Cobalt Strike tab, and this is a quick way of grabbing screenshots for your report. Interacting with the user's desktop through VNC is bad Tradecraft, so I highly recommend keeping it view only as much as possible. What else can we do? Let's go right-click Meterpreter. Let's go to Explore. If we go to Explore, Browse Files, we get a file browser. Through this file browser, we can actually navigate the user's system, and we can use this file browser to download files. For example, if I want to download desktop.ini, I just need to right-click it and go to Download. All Cobalt Strike downloads will show up under View Downloads. This goes for downloads that happen through Beacon as well. Let's press OK. Go to View Downloads. There's our downloaded file. To make it available locally, press Sync Files, and Cobalt Strike will sync the file to your system if you're connected to a team server. So there's the desktop INI file that we downloaded. You may also use the file browser to upload a file or right-click and execute a program. Meterpreter, Explore. We may also see which programs are running. For example, if we look at the user's desktop, we see they've got Internet Explorer open. Let's sort by name, and let's kill their Internet Explorer processes. Kill. And we come over here, and it's gone. We may also use the Process Explorer as an opportunity to choose a process to inject into and log keystrokes through. This keylogger will start the Metasploit Framework keylogger, which will migrate our Meterpreter session. Be careful when you choose to migrate a Meterpreter session, because based on what you've done before, you run the risk of potentially crashing that Meterpreter session. That's why it's helpful to have a beacon on a system first, so you can get back if need be. You can also grab a screenshot, Meterpreter Explorer screenshot, which will take a screenshot of the user's system. By the way, all screenshots are saved for you. If you go to View, Reporting, Activity Logs, here's the folder. Click on today's date, the team server, and here's a screenshot I took with Control T earlier. If we click on this host, I can see there are logs for every command shell I had open, every Meterpreter session, and the screenshots I've taken as well. Cobalt Strike does a good job of logging things for you. Next, I'd like to show you post modules. If you click on this post modules option, Cobalt Strike will expand all the different post modules that are relevant to this particular session. There's quite a few, but you can use these post modules to conduct pre-scripted post-exploitation actions. For example, if I drag enum applications onto this host, we can see it's set to work with session 8. If I press launch, this post module will run and it will try to figure out which applications are installed on the system. The Metasploit framework also stores post module information in a database table called loot. To view the loot, go to View, Loot. And here we can see the application information gathered a moment ago. So let's go ahead and close that. You can also grab a picture of a user's web through a user's webcam if they have one. In this case, Cobalt Strike is going to come back and say the host does not have a camera. So that's a little bit of basic post-exploitation with Meterpreter. I encourage you to play around with it to kind of get a feel for what else you can do. Let's talk about Cobalt Strike's browser pivoting. A browser pivot is a proxy server that injects into the target's Internet Explorer browser. When you, the attacker, browse through a Cobalt Strike browser pivot, you will browse the web with access to any website that your target has logged into. When you use browser pivoting, you must inject into a child Internet Explorer tabs process. The documentation talks more about it. But for now, let me take you through a demo. Let's go through a quick demo of browser pivoting. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. We can see the user has the browser open. Great. Let's set up a browser pivot. Right-click on the host, go to Meterpreter, Explore, Browser Pivot. Here we can see the Explorer process, which won't have session state, the parent IE process, because its parent is Explorer, and a child tab. Highlight the child tab and set up a proxy server. I'm going to set up the proxy server on port 17787. It just happens to be burned into my memory. Now I will press launch. Cobalt Strike will inject the proxy server into the target's Internet Explorer and tell us where to point our browser. This Cobalt Strike instance happens to be in Amazon's Elastic Computing Cloud, so I have to connect to this remote proxy server. Let's do that. Let's go copy. Let's open up IceWeasel. Go to Edit, Preferences, Network Settings, Manual Proxying Settings, and put in an HTTP proxy with the right port, and make IceWeasel or Firefox or your favorite browser use that proxy server for all protocols. Press OK. Now, let's try to browse to a site that the user can access. Oh, help if I had an address bar. View, navigation. Let's go to www.acme.com. We are now browsing to this intranet website available on our target's network. If we come over here to the desktop tab, we can see that the user doesn't see anything we're doing. Now, let's go to their webmail. When I click on their webmail link, I'm brought to a login page for RoundCube. That's no good. Let's hope that the user will log into their webmail in a moment. Oh, look, the user is doing something. The user is going to their webmail. The user is putting in their password, and they've logged in. Interesting. Let me come back to my browser as the attacker, press refresh, and take a look at that. I too am logged into their webmail. And I'm able to go through their email as them. What's cool about this is the user doesn't see what we're doing. I, the attacker, inherit all of their authentication for free. What's even neater, though, about this technology is it doesn't just inherit cookies. It inherits cookies, any kind of HTTP authentication, so Kerberos, Basic Auth, and NTLM, and it inherits client SSL certs. So, browser pivoting is a very powerful post-exploitation technology, and it can help you get past two-factor authentication if it's present as well. When you use Meterpreter, beware that sometimes things are going to work and sometimes they're not. This doesn't mean there's a bug with Meterpreter. It doesn't mean there's a bug with Cobalt Strike. What you can do with Meterpreter depends on a number of factors that it helps to keep in your head at any given time. When you use Meterpreter, you should know which process you currently live in. Use get PID in the Meterpreter console to check which process you're in. If you want to change processes, use the migrate command. You should also know the architecture of your current process. You should know whether it is an x86 32-bit process or a 64-bit process. Use sysinfo in Meterpreter to find out which you are. You can migrate Meterpreter from a 32-bit process to a 64-bit process and vice versa with the migrate command. And if you want my opinion, I think that is amazing work on the part of the Metasploit framework team. That is a really cool capability. You should also know that Windows, it's possible to have more than one desktop session. You should know which desktop your Meterpreter session is associated with. You can change the desktop with set desktop, and you can see which desktops are there with enum desktops. Why does this matter? Well, it matters for things like keystroke logging. If you're not in a process associated with a desktop session, you're not going to see any keystrokes if you try to log them. Likewise, if you're in a process that can't see anything related to that desktop session, you're not going to see keystrokes either. You're also not going to get screenshots as well. Also, be aware that the current process Meterpreter lives in, and even its current thread, has a token associated with it. We'll talk about tokens in the next lecture, but suffice to say, your token represents which privileges you have. You can find out which token you have or which user you are with getUID. You can revert to a past token with rev2self, and you can steal a token from another process with stealToken. Now, let's talk about privilege escalation with Meterpreter. A while ago, I mentioned that the Metasploit framework stores its privilege escalation exploits under exploit windows local. We're going to take a look at those in a few moments. Here are a few privilege escalation options I'd like you to be aware of. Exploit windows local ask. This option will try to run an elevated executable. It will prompt the user for their username and password of an admin user to run with those higher level privileges. Bypass UAC. If the user is a local admin, but you, the attacker, are running in a process with a subset of the user's privileges, Bypass UAC will take advantage of some loopholes to try to break you out of that sandbox. Another module you should know about is Git System. Git System comes with four options. Options 1 through 3 will try different options to elevate you from a local admin to system. System is full control over the compromised system. You can try Git System options 1 through 3 on any system. Git System option 4 is a memory corruption exploit that works great against XP in 2003 called Kitterpot. You can try it on XP or 2003, but beware that it might crash a non-vulnerable system. Also, beware that Git System 0 will try all Git System options, including Kitterpot, meaning it might crash that system. One other note, ask, bypass UAC, and other local exploits will try to run an executable. By default, they will ask the Metasploit framework to generate this executable for you. If your target has antivirus, that's usually a very bad idea. There is a Metasploit framework option called exe custom that you may set to an antivirus safe executable. I highly recommend that you try that option to elevate yourself versus relying on a Metasploit framework generated executable. Okay, here we are back in Cobalt Strike. Let's demo some privilege escalation. Here we have a Meterpreter session. Let's right click on it, Meterpreter, interact Meterpreter shell. Get UID. My user is whatahog on the corp domain. Fine. Let's try git system-t1. We can see we were not able to elevate whatahog from this normal user to a system account. Okay, fine. We need to escalate our privileges. Let's try right-clicking on this host, Meterpreter, access, escalate privileges. Here are our different post modules and local exploits that we can try to elevate our privileges. Let's look at bypass UAC. Let's drag it onto the host. Remember to set exe custom to something that is AV safe. And let's go ahead and press launch. This module will check if our user is in the administrators group, and if they are, it will take advantage of that loophole to give us an elevated Meterpreter session that has the current user's full rights. Because depending on the process we exploited, we might only have a subset of the user's rights, and if they're an administrator user, with that subset of rights, we can't elevate our privileges. So now we have Meterpreter session 14 opened. Let's right click, Meterpreter, interact, Meterpreter shell. Who am I? I'm whatahog. Let's try git system-t1. And look at that, we got system. Let's type git UID, and we're system on that box. We can do anything through this particular Meterpreter session now. Pretty cool. Let's go ahead and kill that, and let's look for other ways to escalate our privileges. Let's go ahead and close that. Another option is we can ask. We can pop up a dialogue on the user's desktop and ask them to run whatever program we give them with elevated privileges. If we disguise it well enough, we say, hey, run java updater.exe. Don't forget to set exe custom. Press launch. We might end up with an elevated session. Let's see what happens. I, the user, have clicked on the dialog I was prompted with. And we can see Meterpreter session 15 opened, and give it a moment to sync. Right click, interact, Meterpreter shell, get UID. And of course, let's try to escalate this one to system. And there we go. That worked. Let's go ahead and close that again. Meterpreter 15, kill. There are quite a few other privilege escalation options I encourage you to look at. Take a look at always install elevated, which is a pretty funny misconfiguration option. It basically allows any user to run a Microsoft installer package, but when they do, it runs with full privileges, full system privileges, even if they're a normal user. So that's pretty funny. If we're a normal user, and we're not in the administrators group, so we're restricted, then our best option for privilege escalation is a misconfiguration. For example, finding a service that is configured to run a system, but that anybody can write to its path. There are also a few memory corruption exploits you can look at too, like PPR flatten rec and MS-13 HWIN broadcast, and a few others. Let's try one of these. I think this is the one I want to try. Keep in mind, this is a unpatched Windows 7 system, so we're going to try an older exploit, MS-1092 Scalevator, Scheduler Elevator. As usual, we can set the exe custom option. Let's just go ahead and leave this as is and press launch. And if all goes well, we will end up with an elevated session. And there we go. Meterpreter session 16 opened. Give it a moment to sync. Interact. Meterpreter shell. Get UID. System. Next, let's talk about pivoting through Meterpreter. Remember, a pivot is just a fancy way of saying that a compromised host is a hop point for attacking other systems. The Metasploit framework manages pivoting through Meterpreter as a routing table. There are commands to add a route, remove a route, and display all routes. The difference with this routing table is instead of the gateway being a router, it is a session. When the Metasploit framework makes a decision about whether to directly connect to a host or go through Meterpreter, it consults this routing table. Now, pivoting is implemented in the Metasploit framework's Rex library. It has its own socket class. So any code that takes advantage of this socket class will honor this routing table. There's a corollary to that. Anything that does not use this socket class will not go through a Metasploit framework pivot, period. Once you have a pivot set up, you need to enumerate the network. Well, not necessarily, but if you want to, here's one way you can do it. Step one, you need to do host discovery. Find hosts that you can actually enumerate. How do you do that? Well, one option is to look at auxiliary modules that look up common ports and run those against the entire target network through the pivot. That's one way to discover hosts. Another option with Windows Meterpreter is to right-click the host, go to Meterpreter, ARP scan. This will launch a Metasploit framework module that will do a who has 10.10.10.1, who has 10.10.10.2, who has 10.10.10.3, so on and so forth to try to discover hosts that are alive. Once you discover these hosts that are alive, highlight them, right-click, and select scan. This will run several Metasploit framework modules that will discover open services and follow up those discovered services with version modules to further enumerate them. So that's one way to do host enumeration through a pivot. Okay, let's take a look at pivoting with Cobalt Strike. First, let's set up our pivot. Right-click, Meterpreter, Pivoting, Setup. Cobalt Strike will show us all the networks the host is on and give us the option of adding a pivot into any of them. Press Add Pivot. We now see that a route is added for this particular network. Let's go to View, Console, type Route Print, and we can see that route. Now, let's discover some hosts. Right-click, Meterpreter, ARP scan, and we will get the same dialog showing us the networks this host is on. Again, let's press ARP scan. Now, this post module is starting to discover hosts for us. Let's right-click in here, go to Layout, Hierarchy. And here you get the view that Armitage is famous for, which is the visualization of your pivots. I'm pressing Control minus to shrink this to fit the whole network in here. And I think this is about everything. Now, let's scan these hosts. Since we have a pivot set up, we're going to need to use the MSF scans feature. Let's highlight the hosts we want to scan. I'm holding down Control and Shift and clicking on these different hosts. I'm going to avoid the broadcast addresses and the router, and I'm only going to scan everything else in between. So let's go ahead and right click, scan. The MSF scans feature starts with a port scan through a Metasploit framework auxiliary module. Once this port scan completes, this feature will follow up each open service with an auxiliary module to further enumerate it if there's an auxiliary module to do so. Scanning through a pivot can take time, so be patient, wait a few minutes for it to complete. Or in this case, we got lucky and it decided to cooperate. But as you can see, as information is discovered about these hosts, the icons are starting to change to reflect that discovered information. We can see a Linux host already. Now we can see several Windows systems. Just waiting for a couple of laggards. And that's an example of scanning through a pivot with Cobalt Strike. Now, if you get lucky and hit the lottery, you can actually fire an exploit through a pivot. In this case, I'll search for MS-867, double-click it. And because I've got three hosts highlighted, this will actually launch the module against all three hosts. And if we get lucky, and one or more of those systems is unpatched, we will get our lightning bolts. And there we go. We have three Meterpreter sessions now by launching an exploit through a pivot. Systems we might not have otherwise been able to reach. Now, let's talk about external tools. I mentioned earlier that it's not possible to use external tools through a Metasploit framework proxy pivot. That's only partially true. It is possible to do so. What you can do is start up a SOX proxy server that uses that Rex socket library to fulfill requests. Go to Cobalt Strike, SOX proxy. This will start up that proxy server. Anything that goes through this proxy server will take advantage of the Metasploit framework pivots that are set up. Now, how do you force things through this SOX proxy server? One option is to use tools that are proxy aware. Nothing wrong with that. You can also use a Unix program called proxy chains. And proxy chains will intercept any outgoing connections from a program and force them through a proxy that you configure. Let's take a look at this. I'm going to show you this external tools trick with proxy chains, but let me do this in a little bit more of a case study. We have access to a system called Josh Dev that is owned by or used by a developer. What I'm going to do is first, I'm going to set up a keystroke logger on the system. I'm going to see here, Meterpreter, explore, show processes. I'm going to inject a keystroke logger into explore.exe. I could use the Metasploit Framework's keystroke logger, but we're going to use Beacon. So I'm going to press inject. And I'm going to double click on the payload option and choose a DNS beacon. Hit choose. Now I'm going to press launch. This will give me a DNS beacon on this particular system. Let's go to view, beacons. We can see it's beaconing back. I'm going to right click, go to interact. I'm going to tell it to sleep on a 10-second interval. I'm going to tell it to start logging keystrokes. This beacon is now living in their explorer.exe. Now, I'm going to pull up the user's desktop. Meterpreter, interact, desktop. And here we go. We can see the user's desktop. Let's watch what they do. Good, I see my beacon called back. Now, back to where we were in the story. Let's watch what they do. The user is going to open up PuTTY, connect to something, and they're going to log in. They're now going to some repository and they're going to work with some source code. I want this source code. Let's go to my beacon and let's tell it to check in. By forcing it to check in, we will get back any keystrokes it happens to have. And there we go. We can see all the keystrokes Josh was typing. We can see he connected to devsource.acme.com. We can see a username password. And we can see what he was doing. That's useful to us. Now, let's look up the devsource system. What is it? Shell, nslookup, devsource.acme.com. There we go. We can see that devsource.acme.com is 192.168.57.18. That's a private address. I don't see it on this network. Let's do shell IP config. Okay, we can see that this system actually has two interfaces. We want to get to 192.168.57.18. All right, how can we do that? Well, one way, we could actually proxy pivot through beacon, but I'm showing off Meterpreter and its ability to double pivot, so let's do that right now. Let's right-click on Josh Dev, go to Meterpreter, pivoting, setup. Let's choose that 192 network and hit add pivot. Now you can see 192.168.57.8, that's me. We could go to host, add host, and add that dev source system, which is 57.18. And if we're really curious about it, we could scan it. This scan is happening through a double pivot. So just give that a moment. Okay, there we go. We have scanned this host. We want to reach it. Let's go to Cobalt Strike, SOX proxy. We're going to start up the Cobalt Strike SOX proxy on port 1087. It's actually the Metasploit Framework SOX proxy, excuse me. So let's go ahead and launch that. Now I need to point proxy chains to this system on port 1087. So let's get my IP address because we're in the cloud. There we go. Don't let me forget 1087, okay? So what I'm going to do is come over here, open up a tab, and I'm going to open up etsy proxychains.conf. I'm going to go to the bottom of this file and change SOX 4 to SOX 4, the address of my system with a pivot, put in port 1087. Now proxy chains is configured. Now if I type proxy chains, SSH, user, the keylog user information, which is in our beacon here. Let's see here. JSOCL at, by the way, no similarity to any person living or dead, even though JSOCL might know different. So SSH JSOCL at this particular IP. And here proxy chains is intercepting our outgoing connection, forcing it through the Metasploit framework. And let's put in the password, Josh Rocks. And he does, if it was a real person. And here we are. We have SSH'd into this particular system. And we're logged in from the second interface of Josh's Windows workstation. Now I can do what Josh was doing. I can go to the repository and I can go grab the source. But I'm not limited just to SSH. I can do SFTP this way as well. So that's one example of how you can bring external tools into this configuration with all the pieces between Beacon, Meterpreter, and Cobalt Strike. In this lecture, I introduced you to Meterpreter, a remote administration tool built into the Metasploit framework written by Matt Miller originally. I took you through how to use Meterpreter and how to do basic actions. I also showed you Cobalt Strike's browser pivoting technology. We spent some time on privilege escalation, and I also took you through pivoting and using external tools through a pivot. This concludes Lecture 6 of Tradecraft.